As I said last week, the way I see Song of Songs, I spent last week introducing it, I see it as an anonymous poem that speaks of the power and the delight of young sexual attraction and extols the blessedness of that attraction culminating and being satisfied in marital exclusivity. It's about sexual love that finds fulfillment in marriage. Now, it relates to or is directed to, you remember we went through verse 1 and Song of Songs, which is to Solomon, and what is the significance of that? It relates to or is directed to Solomon as Israel's most notorious representative of one who took a contrary marital path, one who rejected or missed God's ideal for human sexuality. So as I see it, the psalm, it speaks to all mankind. It speaks of, it refers to Solomon as kind of this foil, as the one who missed God's ideal, and therefore that brings into sharper relief the starring couple. And with regard to Solomon, it speaks to all mankind to the extent that our sinfulness likewise rejects or misses the ideal. So here we have Solomon as a classic case, the most notorious example, and serving as this foil. But we all can relate to that because we all, to some extent, miss or reject that ideal. We fall short of it because of sinfulness. And as I said, behind all of this and magnifying the song's significance is the larger truth that the marriage relationship has from the beginning. It's been a metaphor for God's relationship with his people and Christ's relationship with the church. So the joy and the depth and the excitement and the intimacy and the fulfillment and the exclusivity of the marital relationship as poetically idealized in the Song of Songs, it speaks to the relationship that God intends for us to have with him. So you have this portrait of human sexuality being expressed in marriage, and then behind that is the metaphor. And so you have kind of this double thing going on. Now last week we were looking at chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, and I'll read it again. Here's the woman speaks. It opens up. You have the first line, Song of Songs, which is to Solomon, and it says, oh, that he would kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your caresses, and I spent quite a while explaining how caresses really involves sexual touching. It's not simply, many times it's translated love, which speaks of a state of mind, and this is different than that. So it says, for your caresses are more delightful than wine. As for fragrance, your oils are delightful. Your name is poured out oil. No wonder the eligible young women love you. Take me away with you. Let us hurry. May the king bring me into his bedroom chambers. And then the daughters of Jerusalem, we will exult and rejoice in you. We will praise your caresses more than wine. And the woman, rightly do they love you. Now last week we were looking at that, and you see that this poem, it opens kind of explosively with this vivid picture of the depth and the power of sexual love. The young woman is filled with sexual desire. She's longing for these deep, passionate kisses from her man, the person she loves, and for the sensual delight that she anticipates their lovemaking will be. Now, the fact his name is poured out oil, I mentioned last week, this is an indication that he's a man of substance and character, that his name is like a pleasing fragrance. So when you speak of him in the community, people aren't going, oh, that guy's a jerk, you know, or a criminal or whatever it is. Oh, wow, see, he's received that way. So he not only, she's attracted to him physically, but he's a person of depth and a person of character, and she's somebody, she loves, her love for him is not merely physical. It's certainly physical, but it's not merely physical. See, she is crazy about him as a complete person. And right when we ended, I was making the point that her longing for the fulfillment of her sexual attraction, for her king to carry her away to his bedroom, it's expressed in anticipation of their coming marriage. See, anything else, the idea that any of this would carry on outside of marriage would be unthinkable in the context of Scripture and ancient Judaism. So this is the framework of this, that this is to be expressed in anticipation of their coming marriage and their wedding and the consummation of that relationship. It's the centerpiece of the book. So you see in chapter 3, verse 6 through chapter 5, verse 2, you have that as the centerpiece. So that's what she's looking forward to. And then we'll carry on here. You see that most scholars, when you talk about like the king, when I mentioned about Solomon, most scholars recognize that her reference to the king, to her man, her beloved, and the reference to him as the king, it's not intended to be taken literally. So that's not some odd, quirky thing. That's not something that's forced. It's recognized by most scholars that that reference is not something that's literal, but it's within the poem. It's an expression of her attitude toward him. It's an ascription to him of the dignity and the nobility and the honor of royalty. See, he is, in her eyes, he is a king. He is her king. Indeed, it's thought that in some ancient Near Eastern marriage ceremonies, that during the period of the wedding festivities, that the bride and groom were referred to as king and queen. So if that's the case, you have then another thing. So it's not simply her ascribing to him this honor in these things that are tied up with a royal title, but you'd also have this thing that culturally there would be this connection of king and queen with the marriage relationship or the wedding festivities. So I think this is what's going on here. Now, if that's correct, she's anticipating fulfillment of her passion on her wedding night. And so you can see how that reference to the king in that setting makes sense. Now, the eligible young women who were said in verse 3 to love the woman's man, well, they now express their intention to celebrate the marital union. So they love him, they see him as a great catch, but they express their intention to celebrate his marital union with her. And the one flesh union of marriage, that union in marriage, it is a blessing from God. So it's an occasion, you see, for rejoicing. When those that we love enter into that blessing of God, we celebrate. See, because we care about them and we want what's good and right and best for them. And when people we love join together in marriage, that's why we're celebrating. We continue to do that. It's a blessing and we want them to experience that. So the community of faith, you see, is represented by the maidens. The community of faith will amen the sexual intimacy and its fulfillment in the proper context of marriage. And that's, we do that. They did that. And that's something that's good and right. Now the woman confirms again that the young women are right to love her man. Rightly do they love you. In her eyes, they'd be crazy not to. Because he's just, you know, wonderful. So who wouldn't love him? Now you notice how far the spirit of this poem is from the glorification of celibacy that crept into the early church. You see, sexual love is in the God-given context of marriage, is a good and a beautiful thing. And it's not that simply because of its procreative potential, simply because of its potential to create children. You see, the experience and the fulfillment of sexual passion in marriage is delightful for its own sake. And I've often, you know, thought about and commented on how our world and our society caricatures Christians as being people who are hung up on sex. You know, that somehow they're repressed. Somehow they don't get it. And they're fighting through it. That's not the case at all. We are people who understand that God has designed this and given this for full, wonderful enjoyment in marriage. That's where it's designed for. And so we're not hung up on it at all. But that's how we're portrayed, and it's part of the enemy's plan, you see, I think, to demonize Christianity so people will stay away from it. No, I can't have any of that. All right, verses 5 to 7. I am dark but beautiful, O daughters of Jerusalem, like the tents of Kedar and like the curtains of Solomon. Do not stare at me because I am dark, for the sun has glared down on me. The sons of my mother were angry with me. They made me keeper of the vineyards. But my vineyard, the one belonging to me, I have not kept. Tell me, O you whom my soul loves, where do you graze your flock? Where do you give them rest at midday? For why should I be like a covered woman beside the flocks of your companions? Now this young woman who is head over heels in love with the man who's viewed by the daughters of Jerusalem, these young women of marriageable age, she's in love with this man who's viewed by them as a great catch. She defends herself against being looked down on by them. She defends herself that way. She is dark-skinned in a culture that associates female beauty with a paler complexion. So this is what she's talking about, but she declares that she's nevertheless beautiful. So she says, don't look down on me because I'm dark. In this culture here where people are saying, no, that's a Marxist, that's something that's contrary to beauty. Don't look down on me. She says she's still beautiful, and she has a darker complexion, but she's nevertheless beautiful. And she exhibits both the darkness, she says, of the tents of the Bedouin tribes of Kedar. These are known for these dark tents. And she exhibits that, but she also exhibits the beauty of tent curtains associated with Solomon. Not really sure what tent curtains this is. They presumably adorned his palace, or they were part of the tent in which he dwelled when he was on military campaigns, or they were part of some well-known structure that he had built that we no longer know what it was. But obviously the poet, understanding, is communicating here something. When she's saying that, look, she's dark, but she's nevertheless beautiful. And so she's trying to defend herself against being looked down on by these daughters of Jerusalem, these young maidens who see her man as a tremendous catch. And in verse 6, she tells the daughters of Jerusalem not to gawk at her because she's dark. She got that way, she says, because her hostile brothers, her angry brothers, whom she refers to merely as sons of her mother, they forced her to be a caretaker of the vineyard. So these guys, bigger, stronger, in a stronger social position, they forced her to go out and work in the vineyards. And so she says, don't gawk at me because I'm dark. That required her to work in the glaring sun, which resulted in a dark tan. So when she says here, in keeping their vineyards, in doing this work they were making me do, she did not keep her own. She means she didn't protect her own body from the darkening effect of the sun. So she wants them to understand, listen, I'm dark, I'm beautiful, I'm dark because my angry brothers made me go out there and work in the sun, and I didn't protect myself from the effects of the sun, so I'm dark. So this is what she's saying to them. Verse 7, the young woman, then she turns her attention to the young man, the one her soul loves, asking where he'll be grazing his flock. See, especially at midday, when it's time for the sheep to rest. She wants to know, where will you be at that time? She wants directions to his location so they can rendezvous there and spend quality time together when the sheep are resting and won't demand so much attention from him as a shepherd. She wants the time of day when they're going to be resting so you and I can have some time together. Now, without those directions, she'll be left to wander about and hang out among these different flocks. If she doesn't know where he's going to be, you're going to have all of these flocks being shepherded by different people in different places, and she's going to go and wind up and kind of hang out and look and see, well, is that my guy? Let me come over here. Is that my guy? And this single woman loitering around, she fears will give the impression that she's like the classic proverbial covered woman. And I think this is a reference to Tamar in Genesis chapter 38, verses 12 to 19, who posed as a prostitute, you'll recall. Posed as a prostitute, by sitting at an unaccompanied, as an unaccompanied woman at the entrance to Nain. So I think she's concerned that if I just go out there with no more specific directions, then I'm going to be left to just kind of be hanging around. And I, by as a woman who's unaccompanied, I'm going to look like somebody who's, you know, unsavory, a prostitute. She's concerned about that. And you can understand that. So the man then comes back and he says, now we have the man speak. He says, if you do not know, O most beautiful of women, follow the tracks of the flock and graze your young goats beside the shepherd's tents. I liken you, my darling, to a mare among the chariots of Pharaoh. Your cheeks are beautiful with ornaments, your neck with strings of jewels. We will make ornaments of gold for you with studs of silver. So the man now, he speaks for the first time in the poem. This is his first words, and he describes his love as the most beautiful of women. So he puts to rest any insecurity that she may have about her beauty in his eyes. She defended herself to the daughters of Jerusalem. Says, yeah, you know, you don't look down on me. I'm beautiful. Yes, I'm dark, but I'm beautiful. But you can see this insecurity. Does he think so? Does he see me that way? And you see him putting that to rest when he refers to her here as most beautiful of women. And he tells her to follow the tracks of the flock. So I'm assuming, I'm not a shepherd, but I'm assuming you could find tracks where you would see, where are the shepherds' tents? Where are all the people with flocks gathered as kind of a base from which they have tents there, and then they go out to different areas? So follow the tracks out there, and you'll get out into the general direction. And he tells her to bring young goats to graze next to the shepherds' tents, which is their temporary base of operations. And I think, see, having the young goats to graze, that will alleviate her concern about the perception of an unaccompanied woman loitering about for no apparent reason. You see, if you've got these little goats with you, okay, well, you're out there, and what do you do? Well, you're out there grazing. You see, so you will get rid of that potential stigma that you're out there as an unaccompanied woman looking for something from the men. Now, presumably, he's going to make arrangements so he can meet her at that location when she arrives. So he tells her, follow the tracks out there, bring some little goats, be out there among the shepherd tents, this temporary tent city where we're, you know, it's our main operating base, and they will get together. And they'll be able to see each other out there. Then he likens her to a mare among the chariots of Pharaoh because of the beautiful ornamentation of her cheeks and her neck. See, royal horses in that time, I mean, royal horses, they were often highly decorated. And so she, in his eyes, she's splendidly accessorized. You see, she's, you know, in other words, it's not overdone. It's not something that looks trashy or stupid. But it's something, you see, that magnifies her dignity and her natural attractiveness. She's got this, you know, necklace in it, and she's just, whoa. You see, so she's like that, and that's what come down. You'll see throughout this, and you know this from reading the book, the images that they use aren't the images we would use. So you have to put yourself in the culture, not say, oh, that's stupid. No, put yourself back there and see, he's trying to compliment her. And that's how it would be received. And so this is the idea that she's just splendidly accessorized. And in verse 11, he pledges that together they, as a married couple, will make for her ornaments of gold studded with silver. You see, he says here, we will make ornaments of gold for you, that's singular, feminine, that's her. And see, so what I see here is he's saying to her, we as a couple, when we are married, that we together will make ornaments of gold for you studded with silver. And I think it's an expression that she will continue to be exalted by him after their marriage, that she will continue to be esteemed in his eyes as one worthy of such extravagant provision. Now, don't you wish that all men kept that? I remember somebody at work, she was with a guy, and he was, you know, saying nice things about her, and they were engaged. And I told her, I said, you just remind him of that. All the things he was saying about her. You remind him of that. 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road, 20 years down the road. And you tell him, you keep that attitude. And that's what I think he's saying right here. He's saying that I'm going to continue to cherish you. And so that's what I read out of that. Then we have in 12 to 14, the woman speaks. And you know, I said last week, if you were, I have these annotated. These are where you put the people speaking and all that. People can argue about that. I'm giving you the way I see it and the way it makes the most sense to me. He says, and it's a largely from Ian Dugwood's commentary in his 2015 commentary in Tyndale series. It says, woman, while the king is at his table, my perfume spreads its fragrance. My love is to me a pouch of myrrh that will spend the night between my breasts. My love is to me a cluster of henna blossoms in the vineyards of En-Gedi. See, even when she's apart from her loved one, her beloved, I just put it as love, I think that's clear enough, but even when she's apart from her loved one, when he's seated at his table, or he's seated at his couch, or he's away from her, her perfume, her nard, it spreads its fragrance to him. And in the poem, what I think he's saying there is she continues to command his attention. Even when they're away from one another, that she stays on his mind. He cannot get her out of his mind even when she's out of sight. So they have this thing going on and this attraction. And guys, you know that. And she's saying that about this person. He is to her a pouch of myrrh, which is something that's delightful and exciting to the senses. It just has this wonderful, pleasing aroma to it. And she eagerly anticipates he'll be spending the night lying between her breasts. They're together. They're in bed. That's what she's looking forward to. This is what she wants. She's excited about it. And she thinks it's going to be a great thing. And the sweet fragrance of a cluster of henna blossoms in the beautiful setting of the oasis of En-Gedi, which was on the western shores of the Dead Sea, I think what she's saying is that he's a sensory ten. That's how, see, this is how a poet would put this. He says, he's a cluster of henna blossoms. Oh, this wonderful smell. In the vineyards of En-Gedi, which En-Gedi is this well-known oasis. So all of this is imagery and picture. To say this guy is just exciting. You see, he's just really exciting to me. And then you have in 1:15, the man speaks, says, behold, you are beautiful, my darling. Behold, you are beautiful. Your eyes are doves. Then the woman, behold, you are handsome, my love. Oh, how delightful. Our bed is verdant. The beams of our house are cedars. Our rafters are pines. I am just a wild flower of Sharon, a lily of the valleys. The man, like a lily among brambles, is my darling among young women. The woman, like an apple tree among the trees of the forest, so is my love among the young men. I delight to sit in his shade, and his fruit is sweet to my mouth. So the man, he twice declares his love, his love's beauty. And then he specifically compliments her eyes, saying they're doves. Now this is another thing. You and I'd be going, doves? We'd have some other way of saying it. But he's clearly saying her eyes are great. Her eyes are great. So it's unclear whether they resemble doves in their shape, in their color, in their liveliness. But clearly he's taken with her eyes. You know, and you know, eyes like the windows to the soul. When you're looking at somebody's eyes and he's looking at this woman that he finds just like, wow. And those eyes, they got him. He's definitely seeing and focusing on those eyes. And the woman declares her love's handsomeness. And she exclaims it's delightful. And this statement that their bed is verdant. It's characterized by flourishing greenery. That reflects, I think, her expectation that is born of their passion for each other, that they will be fruitful in terms of having children, that they're going to be very productive because they're like burning. And so she's looking and thinking, you know, our bed is flourishing with greenery. It is going to be productive. And we're going to have children. And their love for each other will be the strength of their home. This bond and this attraction that they have for one another, which isn't only about sexual attraction, but this bond that they have toward one another, that's going to be the strength of their home. The beams of cedar and the rafters of pine that will provide the stability and the permanence in which to raise a family. So this is what I think you're seeing now. Now, chapter 2, verse 1, she modestly resists his exclamation of her beauty, asserting that she's just an ordinary flower. You know, she's just an ordinary flower like a desert crocus or a common lily. And that first, the translation of that first term as rose, which you see in a number of translations, is almost certainly wrong. Here's what the New English translation, that's where, of course, we get Jesus Rose of Sharon. But you get here, New English translation says in a note, early English translators knew that it referred to some kind of flower, but were unsure exactly which type. So they arbitrarily chose rose because it's a well-known and beautiful flower. In the light of comparative Semitics, modern Hebrew lexicographers have settled on asphodel, meadow, saffron, narcissus, or crocus. The location of this flower in Sharon suggests that a common wildflower would be more consonant than a rose. The term appears elsewhere only in Isaiah 35:1, where it refers to some kind of desert flower, erroneously translated rose, KJV and New Jerusalem, but probably crocus in those translations. So I think that's something significant. What the woman is saying, you see, she's downplaying this kind of self-deprecating thing. I'm just like a common flower. You know, I'm just like this desert thing, you know, lily, you know, something that's just nothing special about me. And I think she's saying that just in this kind of humility and self-deprecation. And in chapter 2, verse 2, though, the man, he picks up. He picks up on her self-deprecating reference as a common lily, and he turns it into a compliment. He turns it into a compliment of her distinctive beauty. He said, look, if you're a common lily, then she's like a single lily in the middle of thorn bushes. All right, so she's saying this, and he says, okay, but if I put you in this context, you're still standing out. And so I think that's what he's doing. See, in his eyes, her beauty surpasses that of all others. He's just smitten with her. See, he sees her and says, man. And you know that sense of attraction. And in verse 3, chapter 2, verse 3, she reciprocates, saying that her love is an apple tree among the trees of the forest, meaning that he stands out in a positive way in comparison to all the other young men. Okay, so he's somebody who's just better, looks better. She likes him more, stands out. It's the same kind of thing that he has just said to her, and she delights to come under his shade, to come under the protection that he affords, and declares that what she receives from him, his fruit, is pleasing to her. So this is the sense she just says, look, I like you. I like how you look. I like your character. I like what being with you brings me. And so she's just enraptured. And in chapter 2, the woman continues. She says, he has brought me to the banquet hall, and his banner over me is love. That ought to ring another song for you. He's brought me to the banquet hall, and his banner over me is love. Strengthen me with raisin cakes. Refresh me with apples, for I am sick from love. May his left hand be under my head, and his right hand embrace me. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or the does of the field, that you not stir up or awaken love until it pleases. So having spoken of her delight to come under her love's protection, which would occur in their marriage. That is when the movement would take place from being under her father's protection to coming into her husband's household. And so having spoken of that, she anticipates his having brought her to the banquet hall, which is literally the house of wine, where at least in her imagination, if not in reality, the wedding celebration is going to take place there. That's going to be the grand scene. Now, whether this is a woman who's just looking at this and saying this wedding is going to be in such great, a great environment, or if it's really going to be there. But this is what she's thinking. So whether it's in her imagination or in reality, she anticipates his having brought her to this wedding hall or this banquet hall. And in that act, you see, she comes under his banner. She comes under his identifying flag. As her primary loyalty shifts in the act of marriage from her parents' household to her husband's, and he becomes a new source of protection and provision for her. And so you see this is what she's talking about here. You know, he's brought me to the banner, his banner over me is love. So she's now moving into identification with him. And the fact his banner is love, well, that speaks well of their relationship in the future, right? I mean, if that's his identifying flag, and in her marriage she is coming into his household and under his provision and protection, it's a great thing. If you were her father, you'd be delighted that his banner was love. You certainly wouldn't want it to be anger or money or selfishness or any of that. You'd want it to be love. And so that's what you see, I think, there. And then the intensity of her sexual desire, as she anticipates the day of its release, is such that she describes herself as being sick from love. And you say, well, you know, isn't that overboard? It's poetry. It's poetry. You see, the person is drawing out the degree and the depth of her sexual attraction and her sexual desire. She's sick from love. She calls for sustenance in the form of raisin cakes and apples, lest she faint from the emotional longing. I mean, she's like about to lose it, to collapse, because this is something that's so pulling on her. And the only cure for her distress is the sexual fulfillment she will experience in marriage. So she expresses her longing for that sexual intimacy in verse 6. His left hand under my head. She's lying down. His left hand is under her head. His right hand is over. Okay? I mean, you know, they're just given the picture here. This is what she's longing for. And she's thinking of this in terms of their marriage. And that's the only thing that's going to resolve this tension that she has. And so she refers to that. And because of the aching of her unfulfilled sexual desire, because it's so intense, she charges the daughters of Jerusalem not to get that sexually revved up before the appropriate time, because those emotions are able to be satisfied. So she's experiencing this as she approaches her wedding, and she's telling them, you know, don't get that revved up, because it's difficult. See, it's not so much an actual demand as it's a way to emphasize the strength of her sexual desire for her man. It's just a way of pulling that out. She's saying in our vernacular that the wait until the consummation is killing her. That's, you know, we'd say, this is killing me. That's what's being said as I read it in poetry as they approach this time. See, so much so that she wants to spare others that. And again, it's a way of emphasizing the depth and the power of the sexual attraction that she's experiencing. Now, the fact the charge is issued, quote, by the gazelles and does of the field is probably related to the fact that these animals, that they're culturally associated with sexual activity. You say, well, why is that? I don't know. I don't know why it is. But it seems certainly to be the case The man in the song is like a gazelle. In chapter 2, verse 9, verse 17, chapter 8, verse 14, the woman's breasts are like the twins of a gazelle. We wouldn't say that. But there's something culturally that connects these animals with sexual activity, and this association of gazelles and deer with sexuality, it's documented in the broader ancient Near Eastern culture. So it's not simply Israel. This is a broader phenomenon. And so I think when she sits here and says that, I charge you by the gazelles or the does of the field, that they would hear that. You and I scratch our heads going, does, gazelles? But that, I think it's tied to that idea, tied into the sense of that they're linked with sexual activity. And here I think, here's the before the wedding, where you have this, I think, to me, this great picture of the anxiety in these things, or the tension. She says in 2:8, woman continues, listen, my love is approaching. Look, here he comes, leaping over the mountains, bounding over the hills. My love is like a gazelle or a young stag. Look, there he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, peering through the lattice. My love speaks and says to me, and the man speaks, arise, my darling, my beautiful one, and come away. For behold, the winter is past. The rain is over and gone. The blossoms appear in the land. The time of singing has come. The sound of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree ripens its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth their fragrance. Arise, my darling, my beautiful one, and come away. Oh, my dove, in the clefts of the rock, in the crannies of the cliff, let me see your appearance. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet, and your appearance is lovely. The woman, catch for us the foxes, the little foxes that ruin the vineyards, for our vineyards are in bloom. My love is mine, and I am his. He grazes among the lilies. Before the day breeze and the shadows flee, turn around, my love, like a gazelle or young stag on the mountains of Bether. Now, this is a lot of stuff, but I think it's neat. See, having emphasized the distress of the woman's sexual longing as she waits for their marriage, the poet then represents the man's similar longing. So he's emphasized the woman's distress and her longing. Well, now here's the man. He bounds over mountains and hills. Over mountain and hill, mountains and hills like a gazelle or young stag to get to his love. Okay, well, he's pretty, you know, yes, he's into you, how we would put it. And she's naturally, she's very attuned to and excited by his coming. And the setting is around, it's around daybreak. And her love stands outside their family dwelling. She's just getting a glimpse of his darling through the lattice windows. You know, he wants to get a clear shot at her. He wants to look at her. And he's there, and he's just kind of peering. And he just has to get glimpses as he can. And he expresses his desire for her, for his darling, his beautiful one, by appealing to her to come away with him. See, this he's expressing his zeal for her, his attraction, how much he's into her, by asking her to come away with him. It's springtime. So the land is full of pleasing and sensual sights, aromas, sounds. It's a picture-perfect time for them to steal away and to enjoy each other's presence. Just this beautiful springtime setting with the fragrances out and the turtle doves. Beautiful. Let's get away so I can just look at you. I can talk to you. This is what he wants to do. She is to him like a dove among the cliffs. And that she's beautiful, but he gets only what seemed to him to be glimpses of her. See, there, you know, he's pulling his hair out. He says he wants to get a more sustained look at her and spend time with her. He wants her sustained presence. for he can hear her sweet voice for a prolonged time, and he can gaze on her beauty. See, he's as hot for her as she is for him. See, which is why the kind of isolated and prolonged visit that he envisions in a sensual atmosphere, no less, would be morally dangerous. The two of them are really hot for each other. And he's now summoning her to come away alone in this very sensuous environment. That's like warning, Will Robinson. That's a danger when that's being proposed. It could easily become something, see, they could fall, is the idea. They easily could be overcome in that kind of setting by the power of sexual temptation. How many people have put themselves in positions, when Paul tells Timothy to flee the evil desires of youth, part of that's wrapped up in that idea of being wise about the circumstances, situations you put yourself in. How many people have put themselves in there and then wondered, you'd have to be a spiritual giant. You get in some positions, you're just going to be going, look, man, you're a flawed, broken person. So you got to have some wisdom here. And he is so taken with her, he's inviting her to this thing, and all he sees is, I want to hear her voice. I want to be alone with her. I want to just look at her. I don't want to be satisfied with these glimpses and this passing stuff. I just want more time with her. Where I see her clearly. So despite her intense sexual desire, I mean, there's no doubt about that. That's been portrayed in the poem, her intense sexual desire. Despite that, the woman calls for the catching of little foxes, which would endanger their blooming vineyards, meaning cause them to misuse their sexually mature bodies. You see, these foxes would go and damage things. So she calls for them, we have to capture these things before they do their damage. And so here we are, you see, that we have these blooming vineyards. We are now old enough, mature enough. We're about ready to get married. We have sexually mature bodies, and she's calling for him to catch those little foxes that would endanger what they have going. In other words, as much as part of her longs to give herself to him sexually, as much as that's true, she not only knows it would be wrong and damaging to do that before the right time, before marriage, but she also recognizes the temptation the man's proposal would put them under. She knows it wouldn't be right to be engaging in this before we're married. But what I see in your, and I understand you're wanting to get together, but you are about to invite us into a morally dangerous situation. So this is a little fox that must be caught, because this little fox will damage what is valuable. And so I think that's what she's trying to say there. That little fox has to be caught before it can do its damage. And in verse 16, she affirms their mutual love and their devotion for each other. So she affirms that. You see, that's not the basis of her refusal. It's not that she's not into it. It's not that I don't find you attractive and appealing. Not at all. That's not the case. You see, no, the statement he... So you have that, and I just wonder about... there are times, I think, when young women are made to feel that way, made to be put in a situation where my saying, no, not yet, is somehow going to cost me in our relationship. And here's a young woman who sees this, I think, and says, no, that's not right, and that's morally dangerous, and so, no. We have to stop that. Now, that statement, he grazes among the lilies, that may be a way of saying that his attention is focused on her. You see, as she's a patch of lilies. When you have something grazing and there's a patch here and it's focused on her. That may be the import of that. I'm not sure. It may be that. It could also be a reference to his having kissed her in the past. and his enjoyment of it. And why do I think that? Because lilies represent his lips in chapter 5, verse 13. So maybe that's the thing there, that he graces among the lilies. Maybe he has kissed her before, which would that would also emphasize his interest and his focus on her. And it's even possible that the phrase should be translated, he grazes his flock among the lilies. Now, if you take it that way, then that's just another further identification of him as a shepherd. He's already been identified that way. So maybe that's it. But in verse 17, the woman turns her love away. She turns him away because the time is not yet right. So she maintains the imagery you see of a gazelle or stag, but she urges him to go back quickly to the mountains. He comes bounding over the mountains. Oh, man, this guy, whoa. He comes back, he wants to see, he invites her out, and she says, no, you know, and it's not because I'm not into you. It's because I see, you know, it would be wrong if we succumbed, and that environment would be morally dangerous. So go back. Go back. So she sends him back over the mountains, hurry before the day comes to life and extinguishes the shadows of dawn. As Dugwood says in his commentary, her no is a not yet, my love, not a never. You see, that's it. There is a time and there is a place where union is a delight, moral, right, blessed, sanctified, fully enjoyable. But there's a place where it's not. And that has to be understood. So, chapter 3, verse 1 to 5 says, the woman continues, on my bed, night after night, I sought the one whom my soul loves. She's on her bed, night after night. She's dreaming. On my bed, night after night, I sought the one whom my soul loves. I sought him, but did not find him. I will arise now and go around in the city, in the streets and squares. I will seek the one whom my soul loves. I sought him, but did not find him. The watchmen who go around in the city found me. Have you seen the one whom my soul loves? Scarcely had I passed him when I found the one whom my soul loves. I seized him and would not let him go until I brought him into my mother's house and into the room of her who conceived me. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or the does of the field, that you not stir up or awaken love until it pleases. And here, having declined her love's invitation to this temptation-laden getaway, she experiences anxiety over losing him. And that's what I was talking about. See, I think women are put in that position where she's standing up now. It creates in her, will my doing the right thing cost me this relationship? And in our culture, that's rampant. Our culture, it's like, hey, babe, you know, yeah, but, you know, fine, I'll go find somebody else. Tremendous pressure. And so here I think she's having declined that temptation-laden getaway, she experiences anxiety over losing him, and that anxiety is repeatedly manifested in dreams. She's unable to locate her love after searching for him throughout the city. Do you see the anxiety? Have I lost him? Is he gone? Because I stood and did what was right, has that now caused me? Her desperation is evident in her asking the watchman, the city watchman, if he'd seen. So, and then in a typical dream fashion, what happens? She immediately bumps into him. Right? I mean, she's out here. Have you seen my love? Gets the city watchman, the guy who's patrolling around. You think this would be the guy who'd know who's where? You don't know, I haven't seen him. Oh, there he is. Okay, just like what happens in dreams. So she physically takes hold of her loved one and brings him into a place of lovemaking. She brings him to the room where her mother had conceived her, and the desire that cannot yet find satisfaction in real life, it bubbles out in her dreams under the added pressure of properly declining her love's temptation-laden invitation. See, so now having done that, she's, you know, just eaten up and wanting, you know, desiring sexual activity, desiring the embrace, the intimacy, all of that. And she then tells him no. And so this anxiety is now just coming up in the dreams. And given how her unfulfilled sexual desires, now it's now moved to even disturbing her sleep. See, given that, she renews the charge from chapter 2, verse 7. She renews that charge to the daughters of Jerusalem not to get as inflamed as she is before those emotions can be satisfied in marriage. You see, it's obviously poetry, but she's saying, listen, I'm here, and this desire and all this, it's a rough ride. And I think anybody, any young Christian can identify with that. Anybody who's fighting the fight and struggling against the world and all that, and you can feel this with this young girl, and you, I think, can identify with the anxiety. All right, 3:6, I'll introduce, we now get to the central portion, which is the wedding. And we get to 3:6, and the man says, who is this coming up from the wilderness like columns of smoke, perfumed with myrrh and frankincense, with all the fragrant powders of the merchant? And here, I think it's better to take, there's a relative pronoun here. You can take it in the sense of who, or you can take it in the sense of what. And I think it's better to take it in the sense of who, as you see in those translations up there, and not in the sense of what, as you see in those other translations. And I think that because the pronoun, it normally is used for persons rather than things. It certainly can be what, but it normally is used for persons rather than things. And in the two other occurrences of this exact phrase, which you get in chapter 6, verse 10, and chapter 8, verse 5, the woman clearly is the referent. You see, when it says, who is this? In those verses, you see it's clearly a feminine singular, so we know the woman is the referent there. So that's the way, I think, the better way to take it. Moreover, the woman is associated. She's associated with these described perfumes of myrrh and frankincense. She's associated with them in chapter 4, verse 6, chapter 4, verse 14, and the columns of smoke that are spoken of. They are literally palm-like columns. It's not simply a word. They are palm-shaped, palm-like columns, which ties to the woman's poetic description in chapter 7, verse 7, and chapter 7, verse 8, where she is described as a palm tree. So I think it's best to take it as who, and he will confirm that who's coming up. It's the wedding day, and any guy who has stood and watched his wife come up, you understand, you'll get something of the poetry here. When he says, like, well, here she comes. And there's going to be this interesting 7 to 11 where he talks about Solomon, and I'll do my best to explain that, but I think that's the second bell. Thanks for coming.